Hello, everyone. This is Karma Academy for Founders, and we have a new amazing session with Eric van der Loo from INSEAD, who is actually here today to speak about entrepreneurs, and especially entrepreneurs as persons behind the company. My name is Marily Merendi. I'm from Karma Ventures. We are a deep tech focused fund operating in Europe and investing in early stage startups, mostly that are driven by the technology. And oftentimes what we see is that the founders actually get very close to the businesses they build. And oftentimes we sometimes even stop like seeing them as different from the startups or from the companies that they're with. And therefore, I've asked Eric to join a Karma Academy session to share his understanding about the person, about the entrepreneur, and the studies that he has done this field. But over to you, Eric. Please, floor is yours.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Marily.
With how many we are in this? So that I have an idea.
I was told that this is around 20, 30 persons on a session. So unfortunately, only chat is available where you can actually address your concerns or comments and questions.
So cordially invited anybody who wants to raise a question. Well, I'm happy to be here with you. And let's not beat around the bush and go straight forward to the topic. The first slide here is about a study, interesting study, a large study on what is happening with entrepreneurs when they are in their job, in their roles of building up companies, and what is then the result? If you look at it at the meta level, what can we say based on the studies, evidence-based? And then they signal at least four significant common features. One is they face more extreme working conditions than most of the people around them and in the world. And they are ready to do that with enormous levels, high levels of uncertainty, turbulence, complexity, time pressure, unpredictability. That package takes care of that there is stress. Stress is not by definition negative, can be positive, can be energizing in a way, in particular if it is linked to the vision that you have and that you want to pursue. So then you have a lot of wind in the sails to sail along the boat of your company, your startup or your scale-up. Second characteristic is that we see that entrepreneurs have a significantly distinctive higher need for autonomy and job control than employees. That's one of the reasons that they did it themselves, in particular when it is a first generation founder. The third characteristic is that they are capable of doing it with less social support, although there is a whole spectrum also of entrepreneurs who have a lot of social support, but they can be quite self-sufficient and self-starting with a high level of autonomy and obviously very effective and efficient and a strong need for achievement, wanting to accomplish, if not to prove something to self and to others. So these are the first four conclusions based on empirical studies on entrepreneurs. Let's move to the next slide. What is the impact of the stress on entrepreneurs? And here again, large studies show that they are exposed to significant higher levels of stress, often long-lasting, and it triggers a positive financial impact. That's one of the reasons that people do it, not the first one for in the majority of the cases, but it is a significant one. And in many cases, the impact is negative at the physical level, physical health. We come back to that a little bit later. And we also see that in how entrepreneurs are able to navigate through all of this, it's very significant that they keep on linked to a positive drive and a positive effect in order to, that seems to be, turns out to be a predictive and a factor for success if you have this positive effect. And that is not only so significant for yourself in order to, for the sustainability of yourself as a person. And to highlight that, I'm by training a psychologist and a psychoanalyst, and also I'm trained in the, on the business side, in the organizational side. So I deal with entrepreneurs and their companies and their startup and scale up. But here, with my academic hat as a professor, I also took a rather deep dive into the academic literature. Now,
Eric, if I ask here about the last point that you made, is it so that we are talking about external validation that entrepreneur is looking for, or is it only like, you know, let's say internal one that's actually should be required?
Well, it's mixed. There are entrepreneurs who are and quite a few who are driven from the inside out. They want to do. They see a niche. They pursue it, and they are driven to do it because they love it. They are more content driven. They are innovation driven. They are technology driven. And they fell in love, kind of fatal attraction, with a business idea or and a vision, and they smell that there is an opportunity, and they go for it from the inside out. And then of course, it's very rewarding when you get acknowledgement and success and applause from the outside. For some, a subset of the startup entrepreneurs, it is almost out of a revenge, or I want to prove the world that I can do it. Quite a few of the most successful entrepreneurs failed in other contexts or in traditional careers, and at times had a quite negative self-image and could do some repair work in a very constructive way and successful way by creating this startup, also as a way of to show not only to themselves but also to the world, to the outside world, I can do it. I made it. I've done it. I can do it. And so it's mixed. It's not one size fits all, Marily. Now, in the studies, it's highlighted the three D's of entrepreneurship. One is that in a way I refer to it already a little bit. That one of the D's is the dark side, that there are unconscious dynamics at stake, and that may be to prove something or to achieve something, and we will come back to that in the second part of my introduction. A second D of entrepreneurship is, and that is seen as a downside also, is that you can lose quite a bit of money. Not all entrepreneurs are immediately successful, and the loss of capital combined with loneliness creates downsides for quite a few. In particular, if your once successful start turns into something negative, then people maybe also isolate themselves or get a bit more isolated by others, while others don't give up and become serial entrepreneurs. But for some, it is after the first or two setbacks, it's game over. And as it requires an extraordinary amount of energy to do this startup, this founding, a lot of energy, but also it's over investment in terms of time and energy, that may be at the expense of health and relationships. There are quite a few who are so absorbed by the entrepreneurial adventure and venture, that they don't invest enough time in staying healthy and having their relationships and their love relationships or their family at par. So, and that's of course a very painful realization, that once the business success is there, after, let's say, after a few years, then to see that what you also have harvested next to the business success is that you have lost your love relationships or your marriage or a good relationship with children, if that is the case. And a few indicators of how healthy is the entrepreneur and how healthy are you is when you monitor your alcohol use. Are you smoking? Are you still able to invest in physical activities, healthy physical activities? What is the weight? Are you increasing weight or losing too much weight? And how do you feel yourself, how healthy you are? Because if you monitor, if you start to monitor or to become aware that while you have success, that you are paying a price at the level of your health, that is a that's a negative toll on the sustainability of your of yourself as a person. May I have the next slide? Now, more general, not just a study under entrepreneurs, but leaders in general, and that's one of the last more negative slides, it also shows if you are under for too long under too high levels of stress, it starts to impact also the quality of your functioning. So that is at risk. If you don't get it right, it's not only damaging health and relationships, but also the quality of your functioning. In particular, the studies reveal that the quality of decision-making goes down, that there is a lower level of cognitive functioning, because with all that complexity, how open are you to read the trends close by, far away, and to process it and to translate it into options for actions and thinking? Some turn out to become more aggressive, short-tempered, outburst, which with entrepreneurs who typically have more than average dosages of energy, when they use it for the good purposes, they are great builders. But if they are frustrated, that same energy plus the energy from the frustration is available to act out at times. And entrepreneurs are human beings, so you have to get rid of your negative stress in a healthy way. And if you don't channel that, then it may be resulting also in aggressive behavior. You can become more self-focused, and that is impacting your capacity to contain also the people around you. So the stress, once you can't absorb the stress yourself anymore, one of the most significant roles of leaders and also of entrepreneurs is to not only contain their own stress and anxiety and the risks and the setbacks, but also how the team around you and potential investors or family members or friends or team members or employees, they feel also that it can be tough in the business at times and turbulent, and you need also to be able to contain them. So you need to be able to contain yourself and to contain others. Now, containing others is significant, because if you can't absorb them, if you can't be a kind of protective shield towards them, they get nervous too, and you and then you are in bad shape. May I have the next?
I would, Eric, still ask over here, like one question that have you experienced whether the so-called like extroversion or introversion affects whether and how much stress you actually are capable to carry, and how much do you even feel?
Yeah, well, the good news is that there are quite a few entrepreneurs. I guess they score overall higher on their ability to deal with stress. And if you are, in particular, if you are more in the tech sector, for instance, many of them are tend to be a little bit more to the introverted side or to the rational side. Now, that is fine because that reflects a strong link to the content and to deep understanding of what they are dealing with. The technology, for instance, if it is in the tech biz. The strength is at the same time a weakness, potentially, as what might happen is that they rationalize too much and that they're being focused on the content relates to a kind of what is called in psychology compartmentalization, that they connect, they see, they observe that certain issues are not okay, but they put it in a box because they can, their mental structure, often quite a few of those entrepreneurs with who are more tech and more rational and slightly more introverted, they can compartmentalize and put it in a box. But if people around you don't do that, then it is a mismatch. And it may be that your capacity to handle is that you can box issues. But if all around you can't do it, it might be that you are too late to support them or too late to flag how significant it is and that it is not time to box it and to compartmentalize, but to do something about it. Mm-hmm. Is that an answer, Marily?
Yes, and then perhaps like a follow-up question still, like what role does fun play in stress management?
Big time, because you can have, fun is a great outlet, and if there is success, you can have fun and experience fun related and joy and fulfillment linked to the work itself and the great opportunities that's very, very rewarding, like being a kind of artist who can be happy to have made a new sculpture or a new painting or written a new poem or a new product or a new, if that works, that's at the same time to have fun in life and to have an outlet with others to often at the start, many of the founders report that at that startup phase, they have a kind of brothers and sisters, a strong alliance with a core group, and they create a lot of experience a lot of fun and fulfillment in that startup at the relationship level. If you translate fun into drinking too much or going into drugs and then it becomes a different story because then you are at risk of undermining yourself if you are doing that too much. Now, looking at the person of the entrepreneur, I was thinking about this model by a famous Swiss psychoanalyst, psychiatrist, Carl Gustav Jung. You might have heard of him. And he came with one of his models that he says any person, and that also applies to each of you now attending this masterclass, you have two parts. You have your persona. That's the visible side of yourself that people know of you, the way you show up in life. And in the way you show up in life, and the way you have defined yourself, the way you dress, your professional, your choice of education, your choice to become an entrepreneur or not, that is part of your persona. And your context, your social environments, in particular family of origin, but schools and villages, communities, peers, all people throughout your life, they have made all kind of comments about you and how they, but also with expectations. And life is partially to adapt, to how others have told you how to behave and whom to be. So, for instance, people who have a very creative side and would have loved to become an artist, they often get to hear from people around them, well, it's nice to have that as a hobby, but go for a real profession. Or people who would like to become a business person, people say, well, that's risky, don't do it, do something else. As a consequence, a lot of who we are doesn't make it to our persona, how we know ourselves and how others know us. But it doesn't get lost. We carry it with us in our shadow. So if we want to understand the person of the entrepreneur, if we apply it to entrepreneurs, then you as a person, you have a persona and a shadow. And the question is, what do you have in your shadow? And if you want to get to know yourself better, if you want to, what Jung said, if you want to individuate, to develop yourself, you need to connect with your shadow. He called it descendere. You have to climb down to connect and to open up to what perhaps elements of yourself that haven't made it so far into your persona. And there are two categories of issues in your shadow, or materials, or topics, or themes. One is repressed feelings. That's more painful or difficult stuff. That's also healthy to a certain extent to repress it, get rid of it. But it is somewhere there, more painful or darker experiences in your life. But there is also in your shadow what is called hidden treasures, not used potential. For instance, somebody's drive to start up his or her own business, or creativity, or social aspects, or your love to go into science, or you name it. And then the idea is, once you connect to your shadow, climb the stairs up and refine, review your persona, your persona 2.0. So for some, the persona of an entrepreneur is already the 2.0, because they first did something else in life. For others, it is already from a very early age onwards, this is me. I started already at age 10 or 12 or 14 or 16 with my first entrepreneurial activities. Now, for each of us, it's important, if you want to think about what creates the power of me as a person, what do I bring to the table and what makes me unique, that is not only what you have visible and what is visible and manifest in your persona, but it is also what do you have in your shadow that might bother you or that might help you, and that gives, that people often pick up without even you have shown it. Now, I want to give a few examples of that. May I have the next slide? If we look at the strengths of some of the strengths of leaders, creative, original, independence of mind, and a strong internal locus of control. That is, they don't externalize, but they are self-starting. They take responsibility of what I can do, which protects you way a lot against negative stress, by the way. That's a very mature position. Courage to take the risk, and resilience and persistence. Those are four core positive aspects and strengths, and they each have their history, even if you are not aware of it. And it might be interesting to connect to yourself, also to know what are the roots of your strengths in yourself, and do you capitalize enough on it? For many, the roots of being original or independent or courageous and resilient, if you go back to your parents, your grandparents, your great parents, and I have explored many of the stories, the life stories of entrepreneurs, often you see that it is a theme over generations, either that it is handed over, these characteristics, from generation to generation, it runs in the family, or you can see that there are significant experiences, for instance, grandparents or parents who emigrated because of war or conflict or economic harsh circumstances, and they had the courage to go to another country to overcome a difficulty. At times you see that the first time entrepreneur is really connected without even knowing it consciously to that source of strength that runs in the family. But it is not all positive all the times, because the strengths may become weaknesses. So your need for control and your capacity of that internal locus control may end up in becoming overly controlling. And then it casts a shadow, not only on yourself and your effectiveness in your role, but also on your team. And one example I would like to give of an entrepreneur who was considered to be very, very, very good, and they praised him, a big guy, and he said, I get feedback all over my career as an entrepreneur, and now also as a chair of the company, CEO and chair of the family business, that I'm overly controlling and dominant. And people say, could you please do it a little bit less? Now, I asked him in the coaching that I did with him, what comes to your mind? Why would you behave like that? And what was his answer? He said, I don't know. And then I said, what can you relate to a feeling of being in control? What comes to your mind? And then he did put his hands on his stomach and he said, I remember. And he remembered that when he was a boy of about 4 years old, he visited every Sunday the apartment of his grandmother with his cousins of about 10 and 12 years old. And he remembered that the ritual was also first you greet the grandparents and then the children went to another room and the adults stayed separate in the living room. And then at one of the occasions when they were with the children and he was with his older cousins, the cousins opened the window and they, like what Michael Jackson once did with his baby, they hang him out of the window of the fourth floor of an apartment building, and he was terrified, and he should be. And then they took him in. And it's not that that was the only turning point, but it was a sign for him, you better not let yourself be in the hands of others. Take care that you are in control yourself. An exaggerated need for control. That may also be the case with an enormous urge to fight with deadlines, to flirt and fight with deadlines, or having winning as an absolute. Somebody who is an entrepreneur, very successful business person, but people say, could you be a little bit less competitive? Why always to go in overdrive when it is about competition? And he was not aware why. No, that's just me. I'm competitive. And in the coaching, he could link it when I asked him, what comes to your mind with being competitive? And then he could relate it in his upbringing. He grew up in Switzerland. He was a cyclist. And his father was a competitive cyclist. And he became it too. And his father, from a very young age, was his coach. Win, win, win. And he remembered that he did win a lot. And then once upon a time, he did not win, because what happened? He was driving down the mountains And then there was a toddler, a 2-3-year-old, crossed the street, and he had to make a choice. Either I take the risk of hitting the child, or I make a large turn around the child, but then I launch myself to the side of the street, which he did, and he bruised himself, and he injured himself, and it took him time, and he lost. And his father, at the finish line, said, never do that again. You made the wrong decision. You could have taken the risk. You could have passed the child. You should never give up, never lose sight of becoming the number one, which, of course, is not just that incident, but it is a manifestation of a pattern. Now, we all have, and my hypothesis is you too, we all have experiences in ourselves, in our shadow, partially unconscious, that explain, may help to explain to what extent are we actually, with all our strengths, also representing something that makes us a bit more at risk when we go in the overdrive. Being competitive is good, overly competitive is not good. Being in control is good, over-controlling is not good, not good for self, not good for the business, not good for others, etc. Now, I would like actually not to go now in some of the other themes. I have multiple stories of around each of these themes, but I would like to go to another and to my last contribution that I would like to make, but don't show yet the next slide, Marily. I have done recently a study among 44 young Russian entrepreneurs and leaders. And young means not older than 35 years old. And we have asked those Russian leaders, and it happened to be in Russia, it could have been in any other country of the world, but we are now at the stage of exploring to repeat the study in other countries. And we have asked them, what comes to your mind when you think about success? What comes to your mind? What kind of images, sports or movies or images, just images comes to your mind? What comes to your mind? And that is, if you want, if I may have the next slide. If you think, those who think of success at work, what associations come to your mind? What do you associate with success as an entrepreneur and at work? And if you would be willing to share in the chat what is the first thing that comes to your mind?
Yes, please use chat for this, or if you don't feel comfortable sharing, then at least think about the question and what comes to your mind. But Eric, meanwhile, I would ask over here, like with regard to previous slide, that those examples that you brought out were really powerful. And do you see, like, you know, that while you said like these are not like the singular events and defining the life that's ahead of you, but do you see, like, you know, let's say such very powerful emotions that you feel towards like things that, or your persona very strongly, like, do you see that they actually will define you like over a long period of time, unless you really understand them, you are not capable of becoming a, let's call it, successful entrepreneur, for example?
Oh yes. And I see that also with values. I just completed also a study in a global study, actually, but it started first with leaders from Armenia, in the Armenian diaspora, and we asked them, what are your, how do you relate in your case to the Armenian genocide? Because as we know, more than 100 years ago, many of them were killed in generations above. And then we asked, in particular, the entrepreneur the entrepreneurial leaders around the world. Do you see any relationship of those events of your with your grandparents and your leadership now and being an entrepreneur? And they say, no, of course we know it happened, but they never made the link. And then we found a way to make them think about it and reflect, and then they all saw the immediate link. That part of taking control, of being an entrepreneur, fighting for justice, an intolerance for fairness, an unfairness, for instance, that in the core of their, of who they are as a person, linked not even to events in their own life, but in the lives of their parents and grandparents, that made a difference. Like, we have one entrepreneur actually in Germany who had a very successful startup, but his problem is that his best people in his core team leave. Now, why would they leave if it is such a successful company? Well, the point is, he didn't want to share one single share. So he wanted to remain all the time 100% shareholder. I explored with him, what comes to your mind, 100% shareholder? And then he made for the first time the link that his parents lost all their money after the Second World War with the Iron Curtain, with Eastern Germany, and they had to flee from Eastern Germany. They managed to flee, lost everything, all the business, and they ended up in what was called Western Germany. And then the family, it became a family mantra, never give away anything. You need to be in control, otherwise they take it away.
Mm-hmm.
It's another powerful story, I think. So,
I think the chat people are rather shy to answer, but just, you know, from my colleagues, like what I collect is that when we define or try to understand, like, you know, success, then some of them are saying, like, you know, it's an impact to the world. Yeah. Some others are saying, as you said, you know, that this is the same financial reward, or it's like activities that they can afford, perhaps like expensive hobbies that, you know, money is like what they earn from work. Yeah. This is giving them.
Yeah. But let us look at the results of our study. Mm-hmm. And it obviously asks for some clarification. We have made a spectrum. We have found a spectrum. And some individual leaders have associations over the whole spectrum. One is, if you go to the left side, we call it, there are indications of splitting, of creating, that they define success actually, that the fantasy and association is in terms of war and battle, is winning, is my success is your failure. And it came across with very powerful, actually also quite horrifying and fantasies that people have. For instance, one person had, well, for me, success, business success is when I stand on a terrace of a river and I see the corpses of my competitors floating on the river. And then I toast a glass of champagne. Or less destructive, but in a way also a little bit tragic, is when I am alone in my castle and I can eat from the most expensive dishes that others can't afford. So it's very alone, and others, I have it, others don't have it. Another step on this spectrum is that there is still, success is associated with struggle, and now it is solo. I go solo. I can climb the mountain and I can plant the flag on top of the mountain. I win alone. It's not killing others, but I am the solo winners. And then there are people who spontaneously immediately come predominantly with, no, we do it as a team. It is a team. Success is a team effort. And even further on the spectrum are people who see it as, it's not just me or we winning as a team, but we try to create a situation where it's beneficial to all. The metaphor of to grow a garden together, or a vineyard, or with fruit trees, and the fruits are the garden is of the community, and I help to create conditions, and the fruits are for the community, which it's more generative. It's not just for me, but I give it away. I don't forget about myself. And what is interesting is that people, and working with those 44 leaders, they start to see that this was not just a single association, but this reflected, and people could feel how they were dealing with conflicts, how they were coping with decisions. Because you can imagine that it creates a very different feeling if you work with an entrepreneur who is defining everything in the winner takes it all, versus we can have a win-win and a cross-fertilization model. That is a very different paradigm in which to operate in. Now, with this, this is not pathology. This is not psychopathology, or this is bad or good. No, it is realistic that most of the leaders, most of the entrepreneurs, most of all of us have fantasies and impulses over that spectrum. It becomes more difficult if you are overly, because you can be overly generative at the expense of being competitive. Being competitive is healthy. Being controlling is healthy and necessary as an entrepreneur. But if it gets the flavor of killing others, and the winner takes it all, that is a paradigm for some, but I would say that is not very healthy. Now, what I have tried to outline here in my introduction so far is that the person of the entrepreneur is crucial. It's a source of inspiration, it's a source of strength, and at the same time, it is a source of vulnerability and limitations. The more you are aware, and you are open to be aware of that, the better it is. The more you are able to make the step from, and research shows it, from startup to scale up. I have seen, and I have a couple of cases at the moment where tech entrepreneurs have been very capable of doing the first startup phase with friends, with people who know them well, people whom they trust, often from high school or university or from that very first period of starting up the business. But now that the success comes in and the scale gets larger and larger and the stakes get higher in a way, you need to be able to differentiate yourself and to ask yourself the question, am I still the person to lead the company to the next stage, but also in particular people around me? And I'm now in a situation where somebody has with high tech driven has found a very innovative new product in the domain of production, which could potentially, if it is successful, it could transform part of the world, the way we think and approach food production. It could be great for the innovation and creating a more sustainable food chain. And it could be very fast a blockbuster in terms of profits. But he, it's a man, he did it almost single-handed with three or four allies, and they can't follow him in the next step. And they have now, in order to make the transition from startup to scale-up, he has to let in some new team members and to accept that it is not just about innovation and breakthrough technology, but it is now also about how do you build a factory? How do you operate and deliver the product with high quality standards, which is a very different ballgame. And he tends to, as we speak still, to have great difficulty to take that corner. And that may be the difference between him being successful with it and perhaps even losing it. And we see already indications that although he was for a while the number one in the world, that he is not the number one in the world anymore. And if it takes him too long to take this term, he might be at risk of even losing the business. And as you all know, there is a fine line at times between becoming very successful and losing it.
I would hear Eric ask over here, like we in like a venture business oftentimes see that, especially like CEOs, initially founders, CEOs, they need to transition, especially if the business is scaling. And as you said, the team is growing, yeah, that the operations are big, like bigger stake online. That those founder CEOs, they need to scale with business, and not always it is the case. There comes a moment where some of the CEOs need to be replaced. Yeah. Would you say it's a lack of skill over time that you're just capable of running larger operations, or is it rather how you define success and how do you, let's say, how do you work with yourself as a person?
In order to make that next step or to accept not to make that next step?
Both in a way.
Yeah, and I've seen, for instance, in this case that I was talking about this breakthrough in the food technology, that person is now very close to accept that indeed he is not the person to be the CEO for the combined responsibilities of, so he better focuses on supporting the innovation, distinctive innovative quality, and to be the ambassador to the outside world, because he is known, he knows how to speak at conferences. But if he tries to control the nitty-gritty of how to do a scale-up, that down, interfering the success of the total enterprise.